Hey, and thanks for joining me on this kind of long-form tutorial we're going to embark on over the next hour or so. What we're going to do in this one is we're going to input the first two pages of the Star Wars Suite for Orchestra by John Williams, and we're going to input it into the sequencer, and we're going to kind of really dig into its orchestration, its composition, and see how the whole thing was put together. So that's our task for the next hour. I strongly encourage you, this is not the kind of video you can just kind of skip to the end and get the answer and like, oh, that's great. This is part of the journey, and the studying is part of hearing each and every instrument and figuring out how it fits into the orchestration as a whole and what it does to the textures. So don't be fast-forwarding this one. Find yourself an hour where you can sit and you can learn in real time as we put this thing together and reverse engineer John Williams' process. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time in this video concentrating on the technical or the software side of what's going on here. I'd rather concentrate on the orchestration, on the Star Wars stuff. You can see I'm working in Motu's Digital Performer, which is a high-end, one of the world's best sequencing and recording pieces of software. It's made for both Mac and PC. And in my DP setup, I have hundreds and hundreds of orchestral instruments here. And you can see they're all from all kinds of libraries: Symphobia, CineSample, CineWind, CineBrass, CineStrings, East West. I still use an older East West library called East West Quantum Leap Symphonic Orchestra, which has a lot of articulations packed into it. So it comes in very useful for stuff like this. All of these instruments on my Mac are not actually living on my Mac. They're living on a couple of secondary PCs, which are networked to the main Mac via Ethernet, and they're running Vienna Ensemble Pro. Vienna Ensemble Pro has dozens of instances of contact with each of these instruments loaded up. And the upshot of doing things this way is that I'm seeing almost no CPU hit on my main machine, but anytime I click on any of these instruments, like this French horn staccato instrument, for example, every instrument is ready to play and ready to go, so I can purely concentrate on the music and I don't have to spend time chasing down instruments, loading instruments, worrying about my computer overloading. It all just works. So with that, let's dig into the score. And right at the top, we're just going to start. Measure one is tagged Maestoso, so I'm going to put a marker in there. And let me set my tempo to 108, since that's what the score calls for. And let's start at the very top. So we've got two flutes playing octaves there. I'm going to use my search function and just type flute. And what that does is it calls up only tracks that have the word flute in them. So now I can see all my flutes at once and I can decide what is going to work best for this particular sound. So let me just start off. Let's stay with the CineWinds flutes and I'll go with a quarter note. Yeah, that'll work great. So let's put that first flute note in. Done. Okay, now let's add piccolo to that. Next instrument down on the score. Oh, you can see from the score, this is the super high B flat above the stave, right at the top of the piccolo's range. That's the one I want. Here it comes. Great. Let's go for the next instrument, which is oboe. And we'll start with CineSamples again. Now that's a fine oboe, but I wouldn't mind something with some more bite. Let me just audition my alternate, which would be the East-West oboes. And let's see this one possibly. That's a lot brighter. It has a little more attack on it. Let's go with that. It's a little bit loud, but I can turn it down. I have some controllers right here that I can write in and automate instantly. So here we go with the oboe. Okay, I play both oboe parts at the same time. It's fairly easy. I'm not going to micromanage. In this video, I'm not going to concentrate too much on ultimate realism of making the sound like it was played by a real orchestra. It will sound fairly real. It may not sound 100% real, and that's okay. Our purposes are more just to study this orchestration, not to produce a perfect MIDI mock-up. So there's oboe. Let's move on to clarinet. And we've got two clarinets playing. Here is the CineSamples. Oh, that reminds me. Let me just explain real quick. What we're looking at on the score here, this is a transposing score. And even though there are no key signatures, I can tell that These are written with transposing instruments in mind. This is not a concert pitch score. So B flat clarinet is a B flat transposing instrument. So when you see a C on the page, it actually sounds like a B flat. So I've already compensated for that in my template by inserting transpose plugins on any instruments which are transposing. So it's compensating for that automatically. So now on the page, I see a C, I play a C, and I hear a B flat, which is what I need for sequencing a transposing score. I would not use those plugins if I'm composing from scratch on the keyboard. Then it would be counterintuitive because I would prefer to write all in C. But if I'm inputting a transposing score, then it is important. It makes my life a lot easier by doing that. So let's get the clarinet in there. Great. Next instrument down is a bass clarinet. And it's actually already up in my search results. So let's do that one. Now the bass clarinet transposes a major second and an octave in addition. So even though that note is written as the C above middle C, it sounds like middle C or just below it once you've transposed it. That's the note I'm looking for. So here's bass clarinet. And finally, to finish off the woodwinds, let's add the bassoon. That's the one. Let me audition the other bassoon out of curiosity. Now, in this case, I prefer the Cinesamples for sure. It's got that honk and this double sforzando that I really want here. So here's bassoon. Great. Okay, that's it for the woodwinds. And if you've followed me this far, you might think, yeah, that's kind of boring. Well, it's about to get interesting now that we get into the brass, where a lot of the character is really going to start to come in. So let's go find some horns. I may jump. Here's the Cinesamples brass. Let's try this. I'm hoping for something with a little more bite to it. Let me jump down and compare that to the East-West, maybe. Let's try this one. It's kind of got a muted sustain to it that I don't really care for. I might try the staccatos. That's much more of what I'm looking for in the horns. Now, you can see on the score that there are four horn parts, 1-2 on one stave, 3-4 on the other stave. I can see there's some, not contrapuntal, but there's some voicing stuff going on. So let's just start by sequencing 1-2 to start with, and then we'll add 3-4 in a second. Now, I'd really like to get this accurate because it is very highly rhythmic. So I'm actually going to slow down the tempo a little bit. Let's go down to 90 BPM, make my life a little easier. Last note, slightly out of tune. I'm not going to worry about it too much. Those things happen in real life. As long as it doesn't offend me once the whole thing is put together, we should be fine. So now let's do French horn 3-4, which is occasionally similar and then has some different stuff going on. I'll just put it on the same track and overdub it. Made a little mistake. You know what? I'm just going to do that again. There were a couple of mistakes. I could fix them in the MIDI editor. Easier just to replay it. Great. That is the French horn part. Let's go and add next one down, trumpets. Now, you can see on the trumpet part that we have some very fast double tonguing. Now in real life, a trumpet player would double tongue that. On a MIDI keyboard, it's gonna be very hard to play that accurately. I may slow this down even a little bit more, maybe down to 85 BPM. Let's go find a trumpet patch that will suit this. Pick one at random here. That patch doesn't have any round robin, which is not the end of the world for this. That's actually closer to the sound I'm looking for. Okay, let's start with that patch, and then we'll augment it in a second. Fairly close. I'm actually going to tidy that up in the MIDI editor because I do want to get that right. So I'm going to quantize most of that to eighth note triplets. Yeah, let's move those around a little bit. Yeah, that's pretty close. Let's have a listen to that and make sure I did it right. Those notes are bothering me a little bit, so let's zoom in and get them right. I think they're 30 seconds. Yeah, let's try that. Yeah, that'll work great. I just noticed that I sequenced this using a solo trumpet patch, but you can see in here that this is basically three trumpets playing together. We could double this by, could even just, you know, copy this to the other staccato track to get a doubling effect. Actually, I really like that. Let's keep that. The only thing I want to fix about the trumpet part is the first note, at measure one, was not meant to be staccato. I played it as staccato, but it's really a sforzando. Now, I don't need to change that, but I might just layer it with a different articulation. That'll work great. Let me just do that first note and get a little more sustain on it. Okay, let's move on. Trombone is next. And let's go with a similar kind of patch. Need something with a lot of bite on the attack. That's, yeah, the cinnabrass is perfect for this. A little bit quiet, but I'm going to boost it. So here we go. Okay, I definitely messed up that take, but let's do it again. I'm going to turn it up a little bit more. That's pretty good. I'm going to tidy up my MIDI a little bit because those da-ga-da-ga-da were very hard to play accurately. So let me quantize those to the 32nd notes and see. One quantized well, the other one didn't. Let's just copy that over. Quick fix to that. Bump, 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 bump. Okay, that works pretty well, and actually now we're really starting to get that contrapuntal texture between the trombone and the trumpet that Star Wars is so famous for. So you see that device a lot around the score, and it's just beautiful here in the opening measures of it. Now, there's one thing I do want to fix. In measure three, where the trombone goes, ba-ba-ba-ba, that has to be sustained. Right now it's just getting totally lost. So I'm going to overdub just that note using a sustain patch. Because it's got to come out, otherwise the whole line fails. Okay, the next line down is bass trombone. I don't believe that I have a bass trombone in my template. So I think we're going to have to work around that just a little bit. I can see that it is actually completely, at least in the first three measures, just duplicating trombone one and two. So I'm not losing anything big by not having it right now. So let's skip it for now. I can see in bar four, though, it is going to gain a note of its own. So we'll cross that bridge when we come to it. Let's go down to tuba and work towards finishing the first couple measures. So here is tuba. Slightly out of tune. That's perfect for the first note. Let's do that one. Not in love with that sound. Let's switch to something else. That's more what I want. Yeah, let me do that. So I'm going to take away that. Let's just keep that one. Okay. So I think we're good on the brass. Let's move on and we'll work our way down. Next down is the timpani. I've got a cool timpani patch, and nicely the way it's laid out is left hand is down here, right hand is up here. So you can actually play it the way a real timpani player would by alternating between the two hands, which is perfect. And right at the top, I've got a da-da-dung, which is, so it makes it really easy to play. So let's go ahead and stick that in. Okay, and that is our timpani. Let's add triangle. The triangle part, it's all whole notes. It's going to be fairly easy. So let's maybe go back up to tempo and save ourselves some time. So here's triangle. Perfect. Here comes. Really is amazing how much that triangle adds in terms of anticipation and, sorry to use the word, tingling. Like, that's literally what it is. And the effect that that brings to the opening. You know, before we added the triangle, it sounded a little bit dry, but that triangle starts to just give it some life. So the last part of the percussion we need is a crash cymbal right at the top. I'll just go to my all cymbals track. One of those will be great. Okay, we're almost done with the first three measures, and yes, it's taken a while, but hopefully as we put all this stuff together, you're getting some insights into how this thing, how each instrument figures into the whole. So let's finish it up and get to the violin. And we definitely need tremolo here. Okay, here we go. I can do both violins at the same time. They're just in octaves. Here it comes. I don't know if you could have seen it in the video, but I was actually manipulating my mod wheel as I was recording. Because I want those violins to be heard, but I don't want them to overshadow the brass, because the brass is really where the action is at on this. Before we get to the run, let me just go ahead and finish the viola and cello and contrabass, just so that we know that the first section of this is entirely done. So here's some viola, and we'll use maybe a sforzando. I'm not a fluid reader of viola clef. In fact, I'm sight reading this whole score, so you'll have to forgive the occasional mistakes here and there, but I know that's what it should be. All right, let's stick that in right at the beginning. And we'll do the same for cello. Cello sforzando. A little too loud, but I'll just duck it as I record it. And the same with contrabass, double bass, as it's called in my template. We need one with marcato. Let's try that. I don't like that snap at the beginning. Sforzando, maybe? Very similar. you know, actually, honestly, any of these will work for our purposes. Here it comes. this is gonna be fun. Okay, I just noticed that in measures 2 and 3, there's a little bit of woodwind magic that I neglected because of the way I kind of worked my way through the score. So let me go back in there and add that in, starting with the oboe. Ba, 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 ba. So we need something sforzando, maybe even staccato. I think that'll work fine for what we need. So here's that. Then we do have this run coming up, which we should start to think about. Now, let's see the notes. Now, that is really interesting. I was fully expecting it to be just a major or dominant seventh scale. But it isn't. It's got a D flat in it. That note. That is a very interesting color. Just to take this a little bit out of the ordinary and to shade the tonality of this a little bit. It is obviously in major, but it's in major with this added spice added. Now, I do have some runs patches in my template somewhere, but I don't have any with exotic scales, and it would take longer to find a scale that matched that than to just play it myself. So I think I'll just play it, and that's close enough. By the way, let me go ahead and put my double bar in here, or I'll just do it as a marker with the listesso. Marking. Spelled wrong. We're going to talk about it in just a second what that means. But at least we know we're heading towards a downbeat here. So let me put that run in for the oboe, and then I'll go put it in the other instruments too. Okay. Let me go ahead and do that run for all the instruments. That's a good next step. So starting back at the top of the score, I'm going to do the same thing with the flute, and let's find a patch that can play something like that. Yeah, that's good enough. Here it comes. That one, in the flutes, it's actually an octave, so... Great. And piccolo, and I can already tell that, boy, is that going to cut through the orchestra. It's really going to be felt. Wow. Wow, what a shimmer on top that can bring, a biting, it just cuts through the mix, so to speak. I really should say the blend of the orchestra. Okay, so that is flute, piccolo, oboe. Now, the clarinets are also doing the same run. Let's go ahead and stick that in there. Here are my clarinets. Oh, yeah, playing different notes here. Let's do that. And the clarinets also are in octaves, so right there. And now let's skip down and do the violins are going to do the exact same thing. Let's see how we can make this happen on violin. Sorry, D flat. Yeah, let's do that. The violins are actually in octaves too. If you read the score carefully, it's kind of small, but there's an 8VA, an octave sign, on the first violin, and a couple of dashes here, kind of sprinkled here. And then if you go onto page 2, it actually still says 8VA, so this whole line is supposed to be 8VA. Let's stick that in there. Yeah, I didn't really care for this. How that sounded. I don't know why. I'll put that on a second track and maybe I'll turn it down. Yeah, that's good enough. Now I do see a harp doing the same glissando. That's going to be tougher to play because a harp's hands can move in a way that mine can't. But let's see what we can do, or at least simulate it. So it's going to start here. That's the run we want, but I can't play it nearly that fast. You know what? Just for Just going to make it a one octave run. I'm going to cheat a little bit because I don't want to take the time to get that run absolutely perfect. It's barely heard in the context of the full orchestra. It's really just an effect. It's a swoop, a schmear. Okay, so we've made it all the way to l'istesso, and that is all the instruments. I want to hear it one time just for my satisfaction, and then we're going to move on to the next four or five measures. Okay, and that is how that was put together. That is pretty cool. So let's we're going to move on and do the next 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 measures, and then we'll call it a day. Now, the tempo, let's see, at the l'istesso. L'istesso literally means the same, but it's the same quarter note to the half note. So it's basically going double time at this point. And I'm sure everybody here knows the Star Wars theme. If you look at the trumpet line, the ba-ba, ba 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 ba. So what I'm clapping here is the half note. So it's 1, 2, 1, 2. We're in cut time. 2, or if you think of it in 4, it's 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. So basically, we're going at double the speed we were in the first three measures. I could go ahead and stick the cut time in my conductor track, but I think for the purposes of today's video, I'm not even going to bother doing that. I'll just keep it 4/4. It's fine. But I do have to play things double time. So again, let's start at the top. Now when we did our flute run, it was blah, 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 but that last note was short. So I'm going to now do the sustain that we were waiting for. Okay, let's move on with a flute. I would like to, this next section here, the next six measures that we're talking about, they can be broadly divided into about three or four different categories. We have some tremolo textures going on. That's in the high woodwinds and the harp and the piano and the high strings. And then we have the bass accents, the rhythmic accents that really give this the rhythmic underpinning. You can see that in the bassoons, in the horns, in the trombones, tubas, in the snare drum, and in the low strings. And then you've got the melody, obviously, which is trumpets, only trumpets. And then you've got a little bit of percussion on top of that, too. So I would like to take each of those one at a time, just so we can really hear how they work. And the most intriguing of those is the tremolo texture. So let's concentrate on those first. Now, over there on the second measure of the page, we've got a whole bunch of trills going in different directions. Now, I do have patches, like, for example, flute trill, half step, and whole step. It's a beautiful sounding trill, and it would work for flute one in the first measure, but it wouldn't work for the next measure where it has to go C to F. I can't do that. So it works for measures 1 and 3, but not measures 2 and 4 of that phrase. Maybe I'll just use it on 1 and 3, and then I'll figure out another solution for 2 and 4. So here we go. Actually, now that I realize it, flute 2 is in the second and fourth measures is a whole step. So I can just use that instead. Or not instead, I'll just add to it. Okay, so now I've done flute 1, measure 1, flute 2, measure 2, flute 1, measure 3, flute 2, measure 4 of that phrase. So that's not bad, but now let's get the missing ones. And maybe for that, let me try this patch. Doesn't quite transition well. Maybe this patch? That's probably good. So now I'm going to do the opposite, the two intervals that I couldn't record. Here it comes. One wrong note in there I heard that I hit accidentally, but It's pretty obvious which one that is. That one was not supposed to be there. Okay, so that's my flute. Let's do the same for piccolo. And here we have no half steps or whole steps, so we're going to have to play it ourselves. That's pretty biting, wow. Let's see if there's any others that might suit it better. I might actually prefer that one. Let's go with that. Nice texture. It's about to get even more complex. Let's add the clarinet to it. They're doing something almost, it's basically the same thing. So here's some clarinet. Okay, let's lay that in. That was clarinet one. Now I need clarinet two, which is trilling F to G, but I can't put it on the same track because the G's will just conflict and probably make a mess. So, yeah, I'll stick it on that track. It's fine. It's a beautiful texture. So let's jump down in the score and skip all the other stuff. We're going to come back to it in a second, but let's jump right to the harp and the piano and the high strings, which are going to add to this texture in new and interesting ways. So here is my harp track. Yeah, just gotta get the timing right. This may be hard to play at tempo, so I'm gonna slow it down again. So let's do the harp part. And the harp does have a left and a right hand part, but just for my purposes, because I'm sight reading everything and I'd rather get it right, I'm gonna do one hand at a time to get it right. Yeah, that works for the right hand, and now here's the left hand. Nice. My first one is a little bit off time, but I can fix that pretty easily. In fact, we'll just quantize my left hand only to straight eighth notes. There we go. And now let's add some piano to that. It's the first time we've seen piano in the score in the first few measures. Let me take a look at that. A little quiet, but we can make it a little louder. Great. Okay, and now down to the strings, the high strings anyway. Let's go for violin tremolo. Here's the first violins. And now let's do the second violins, who have a complementary part to that. There we go. Okay, and that completes the, let's call it the texture family of these few measures. Really beautiful and interesting texture. And now we can move on to the next one. Let's jump right to the rhythmic underpinnings, the low stuff. So you can see I'm going to get bassoon, low brass, timpani, snare, and low strings. So if we add all those together, we're going to add a nice element to this. And this is like very rhythmic and very biting, which is going to propel this whole section forward. So as usual, I'm going to start towards the top of the score. Let's do bassoons first. And I remember liking this patch. Yeah, let's do that. Might be a little quiet. Let's boost a little bit. And we're going to have to go back to the listesso. Boy, you can barely hear it. It's a little quiet. But I don't want to make it too loud. It's not the melody. Let me do it one more time. Yeah, that's the bassoon part. Although now I just noticed bassoon 2 sometimes goes down to the low B flat. So I'm just going to punch in just those extra low B flats on the same track. Yeah, that's going to work really well with, I know we're about to hit the horns, which are about to give this a whole lot more oomph. So here, I may use this patch again. All right, here we go with the horns. Same thing. Interesting resolution there. That happens. I can see that happens in a couple of different instruments. Yeah, that's key to this piece working. Let's skip over the trumpets. We know they have the melody, and we know what they sound like. We'll put that on last. Save ourselves. Here's some trombone. And again, I need some biting attacks on these. So how about this one? That's exactly the sound I want. Let's go with that. I'm not worrying too much about mixing and matching libraries to libraries. It's really about what sounds right. And later on, if this was a piece that I was composing, there'd be ways to massage it and to make instruments fit in with other instruments better and that kind of stuff. But for right now, this is more of an orchestration tutorial, so I'm less concerned with consistency from instrument to instrument, more interested in how these instruments actually work. So let's sequence the trombone starting at the listesso. For my first measure was a little bit sloppy, so I'm going to fix that. Where am I? Ba-da-da. Just get that first exclamation right. Okay, but that... Ooh. What did I play? Yeah. Ba-da-da. That's got a sustain, so let me just stick the sustain in there. Yeah, that'll work. Maybe that one, actually. That didn't quite match, actually, now that I hear it. That probably will. Okay, and last for the brass, let's add the tuba. And I do need something marcato or staccato. Here we go. Nice. That's it for the brass. Let's go on to timpani. Same patch as before. Here comes. Timpani always provides that pomp and circumstance, the gravitas of this bright orchestral fanfare, so it feels great. Next, I see there's a glockenspiel there, and it's tremolo or a roll. That's the pitch it would be. I can't play it accurately, but you know, I may slow the tempo down way, way slower and play it as fast as I can to simulate the same kind of effect. Yeah, that is actually very similar to the triangle that was used in the first three measures. Same kind of feeling, same kind of effect. Okay, let's go, that's way too slow. Bump the tempo back up. And let's do my snare drums, which make their entrance here. I've got one key that does rolls. I've got other keys to do individual hits, so I think between them I can make this happen. Yeah, I want to make sure that snare doesn't poke out too much, but it's got to be in there just to add the marching, almost the military flavor of this. So that's the percussion. Let's now skip down to the low strings and get all those stabs in there. Viola, I'm so excited about reading viola clef right now, I can't tell you. Okay, where are we? So okay, that's the part. Let me just find the right patch now. Not quite right. Completely different character between the libraries. Nothing wrong with that. I'm just trying to find the one that's going to fit in the sequence the best. That's the most homogeneous kind of sound. I'm going to go with that. Boy, that glockenspiel is killing me. I've got to turn that down. It's just way too loud. So let me go in here and record and enable my glockenspiel, and let's turn it down some. Side note, I know I said I wouldn't spend a lot of time on technical stuff, but having a MIDI fader box of some kind is very helpful because I have all these faders ready to go and I can make adjustments like that on the fly and just automate the volume of this one particular track without having to go and find stuff. This is actually a Korg Nano, what's it called? Nano Control. I didn't like its original color, so I took it apart and I spray painted it black so it matched the rest of the studio. But it is otherwise about a $30 fader box with about 9 faders on it and knobs and a couple of control buttons, which is kind of fun. You can make them do all kinds of things, whatever suits your template, but that was an investment well worth spending. Okay, so let's finish up this sequence and go down to cello and yeah, I love that sound. Too loud, but we can turn it down, of course. Made a little goof in there. I'm going to record that one more time. Okay, down to our almost last instrument, down to the double bass. Staccato, maybe. No, I need something with more bite, though. And the more low end, the better. Let me try something down here. I don't like that attack. I'm not in love with any of those, actually, but that might be the closest, my favorite of them all. It's very dry. I could go into the mic settings and pull up some more room tone for that, but for the purposes of today's orchestration, I don't think we need to do that. Let's sequence that double bass part. Caught that little line there. It's barely audible in the full orchestral sequence, but up the octave. Boy, that little detailed touches like that can so take an orchestration from being very ordinary to exceptional because you've got the balance of power kind of swinging by an octave. It's a subtle thing, but in a real orchestra playing this, that octave jump would have a big effect. So can't underestimate little details like that. John Williams is, of course, not only a master composer, but a master orchestrator too. And I assure you that octave jump was not by accident or by whim. It was well thought out to enhance the drama of the situation. Okay, so we're basically just about done. The last thing we need is the trumpet melody. And I can see in the score that he's got 3 trumpets playing unison all the way across. So I can choose any trumpet ensemble patch. We haven't used 8DO at all today, I don't think. Yeah, but the crescendo is not going to work for me. Strange, even the sustain patch, I may have to debug that. It may be triggering the wrong instrument, but I don't want the crescendo. I want actually full-on melody. Let's try cine-samples. Yeah, that's the sound I want. So let's bring that out. Of course. I wish we could finish this, but we didn't turn the page. That's the full sequence. I can't wait to bring this up to tempo. And, oh, you know what? One last thing before we bring it up to tempo is we're so accustomed in the opening to hearing a slight rallentando, and the score does say poco rall right before the licessa, right before measure four. So I think we should do that. So in my conductor track, I'm going to write in at measure one. Let's put the tempo change and make that 108. And then at measure four, let's do another tempo change to 108. But in between that, in measure three, we'll do just a slight rallentando. So I'm going to change my conductor track. And let's say from measure three to measure four, we can just go linear for now. But we'll do 108 to, 95. Let's maybe try that. Let me double check that to make sure. It overwrote my measure four. So at measure four, I definitely want it to go back to 108. So now we got a little rallentando there, and I have to tell DP to follow my conductor track, which it has. And now for the masterpiece, let's hear the whole thing finished. Okay. Okay, so that is the entire first two pages of Star Wars sequence. That was really exciting. I found it tremendously educational to be able to go note for note and pull up each individual instrument and then put it in its context. This is the kind of experience, the only other way to get this would have been to be in the room during the recording session or part of the orchestration as it was being written. So I hope you've gotten as much out of it as I have, because I've really enjoyed putting this in. Definitely feel free to leave your comments below. I may consider doing this for other scores in the future, just to just for educational purposes, to sharpen myself as a composer and an orchestrator. So I'll see you next time. Thanks for joining me.